drawer of Nancy's knickknacks. And in this short video, I'm going to show you how to fix wonky balls by adjusting how the O-ring on your ball winder fits against the shaft that protrudes up from the inside of the ball winder. This is a very simple fix. It takes only a few moments, and occasionally you'll have to make this adjustment if you ever run into a wonky ball. So let's get started. Before we get started, let me explain the different parts of the ball winder we will be working with today. This is the spindle arm, the wooden piece. It holds the spindle. This is the spindle. And this is the collar that goes on the end of the spindle shaft. The clamp ring is this gray material down here underneath the spindle arm. Those are the essential parts that we'll be working with in this video. This is the conical shaped shaft that comes up out of the ball winder, this pointed steel shaft. Whenever you make any adjustments on the spindle, it's a good idea to take the collar off the spindle shaft. And you do that with the 1/8 inch Allen wrench. The reason for that is that collar sometimes can get jammed up there too tight, and it actually restricts the motion of the spindle on its axis. And when we ship each ball winder, we adjust the position of the arm and the spindle so that it fits on the conical shaft correctly. However, during transportation, during installation by the user, it can get out of position. So it's a good idea, if you're setting it up for the first time, to actually remove this arm, and I'll show you that in a minute, and then reset it. Now you notice I'm using a nut driver. It's a 5/16 inch nut driver tool. It's much quicker and easier to use than a screwdriver for this application. So I highly recommend that you get one. You can get one at any Lowe's or Home Depot's for about $5. Or you may already own a nut driver. But when you use a nut driver, you simply put it in there, loosen each nut about a quarter to a half a turn, and you can lift this entire assembly right off. Keep in mind, we've already removed this collar. So we can take the unit apart at this point. You can see that it spins freely. There are two bearings inside this dowel housing here, and occasionally they get out of alignment, and if they ever do, you'll notice that the unit won't spin freely. So if you have that problem, please give us a call. We can tell you how to correct that. In any event, you would lift the unit off, and then essentially you place it right back down. Now you notice how I'm holding the spindle arm, by the way. I've got my hand underneath it. I'm really grabbing the collar, the clamp ring, I should say, and I'm setting it down very easily until that O-ring just makes contact. So as it makes contact, I tighten it up, and then I test to see if it spins. Now, if it's hitting too high, and this one looks like it may be hitting too high on that shaft, there's a number of things I can do. I can take it off again, of course. Make sure this is fully seated down. And force it down a little bit further by holding it and pushing it down further so that it makes contact further down that shaft before tightening it. You never want the O-ring to make contact with the very tip of the shaft, right up here. And what I mean by that is you don't want the O-ring to actually ride on the tip. Since the O-ring is curved, circular, and if you were to cut it in half, you'd see that. It actually looks like it's hitting up there on the tip, but in fact it's not. It's actually making contact further down, and I'll show you that in a moment. Here you can see how the O-ring makes contact with the conical shaped shaft. You know, once again, since the O-ring has a curved surface and it's got a, I think it's a 3/16 inch diameter, it takes up a fairly big space, but in fact it's only making contact on part of its surface with that shaft. Okay, you'll notice it's not actually riding on the tip. The tip is slightly above the O-ring. Essentially, the O-ring can make contact with, you know, anywhere between the halfway point and about the three-quarter point. That's the sweet spot of the contact point. If it hits up higher, what it means is the strands of yarn will be spaced closer together. And there's not much you can do about that except trying to force that down. You don't want them too close and you don't want them too far apart. A properly shaped ball will have strands of yarn that, you know, are probably an eighth of an inch to a quarter of an inch apart as you're winding the ball. In order to get the proper fit, you may have to remove the entire spindle arm, set it back down, and in this case I've loosened the screws a little bit more than normal. You know, again, normally you should loosen 1/4 to 1/2 turn each. If you loosen them too much, then there's a tendency for it to do this, and you don't necessarily want to do that unless you're not able to get the O-ring to ride lower on the shaft. So by making it a little loose, you can get more gap in there. Then you force it down. I'm going to take it off to show you, accentuate how I'm doing the movement. I'm pushing in that direction as I'm lowering it down. And that forces the O-ring to sit lower on the shaft. Now, as you tighten those, it'll want to tend to come back into that position. So you just have to sort of hold it in that position. And then you have to make sure that this one's not tight enough. And then you turn it. That's a turning test. I often say it takes about the same amount of energy to turn the spindle when it's properly adjusted as it does to turn a doorknob on a door. If it's much harder than that, then it could be sitting too tight. At some point, if it's too tight, if that O-ring is too tight against that shaft, you'll create wonky balls because the spindle will not, in fact, turn during its motion. Now, after you got it adjusted, you need then to replace the collar on the end of the spindle shaft. What I often do is take a business card or a piece of paper or something like that, something that's got very little thickness, push it up there, just so you get the feel of where it should be, and then I tighten that set screw. That's not a critical adjustment, but it prevents you from jamming it up too tight underneath the spindle arm. The whole reason that collar is on there, by the way, is just to prevent you from pulling the spindle off when you're removing your yarn. So you don't want to jam it up too tight, and you don't want to leave it too loose either. If it's too loose, that will enable the spindle to lose position when you go to pull your yarn off. And once it leaves the proper fit, you have to readjust it just like we did earlier, because now it's not fitting against there properly. The other test you can do is a spin test. This is the motorized unit I've got this on, so I can't really do the spin test. Spin test involves when you have the handle on, you turn the handle really fast and then let it go and count how many times the handle continues to turn on its own. It should turn 3 to 5 times on its own. If it does that, that means it's not too tight. The O-ring's not too tight and it's probably fitting properly. The other way to test it, and I'll show you that in a moment. In this test, we're going to see how the slot where the yarn goes is turning. And that's something you could do when you have your handle on, simply by turning the handle and after every turn or two, seeing if this groove slightly turns to the right or the left, depending on which way you're cranking it. Now, since I've got this on the power base, it's motorized, I can't crank it just one revolution per time, so I'm going to have to stop it after each second or so. But notice the position of the slot right now. And you'll notice how the slot moved up. It's slowly but surely going to be turning clockwise in this case after every turn or two. Notice how it's positioned now. So what that's showing us is that the O-ring is making contact with the shaft, and in fact it's causing the spindle to turn on its axis. And the proof of that is by looking at the slot. So that's how you can show yourself that it is in fact set properly. That's really the proof in the pudding that you've set the O-ring up properly, that the spindle is indeed turning on its axis as it should and as it must to avoid wonky balls. If the O-ring were too tight, you would not see that slot moving on each rotation or two. It would stay in the same position, which would mean your yarn would be racking up or stacking up on top of itself, and that is not what you want to do. That would create a wonky ball. So I hope this has been helpful for you to see how to make the adjustment, the critical adjustment for avoiding wonky balls. That's really the only adjustment you ever need to make on the ball winder. There's no other adjustment that you can make, actually. Removing the collar is one thing on the spindle shaft. Make sure that's not too tight. And making sure that the O-ring fits properly against the steel shaft coming up out of the ball winder. That's the only thing you can do. And that's the only thing you need to do. So hopefully that'll be a simple adjustment for you to make occasionally in the event of a wonky ball. I find that after repeated use over a long period of time with the possible movement of the spindle due to pulling the yarn off periodically, that's the adjustment you have to make, and it has to be made possibly once or twice a year. It could be more often in your case, but if you set it up properly and you reinsert the collar on the end of the shaft, which prevents the movement of that spindle, you should be able to avoid having to do this very frequently. Also, never lift the unit by the spindle arm or the spindle itself. Always lift the unit, if you're going to move the unit, by the body of the ball winder. That would also prevent possible adjustment problems from occurring. Okay, thank you very much. If you have any questions, please give us a call, 800-731-5648. Thanks.